My name is Hannah Delpiez. I'm one of the senior clinical dietitians here at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. And today we will be doing the second Blum recorded session on symptom management through treatment, part two. You can access the previously recorded session on part one from last month. And just as a recap, in part one, we talked a little bit about nausea and vomiting, constipation, and diarrhea. And today during part two, we will be talking about anorexia or lack of appetite, early satiety, taste changes, dry mouth, mouth sores, and fatigue. So in general, one of the patterns that we can see as you progress through your chemotherapy, radiation, surgery, or other treatment is as treatment-related symptoms increase, and this could be related to cancer, it could be related to the treatment, it's not uncommon to see that in conjunction with that, as symptoms increase, that appetite and ability to eat have a tendency to decrease. So one of the first things that we oftentimes are faced with is patients who are experiencing that lack of appetite, or sometimes you'll hear that referred to as anorexia, or also early satiety. So they may be full more quickly or more easily. So a couple of the more straightforward strategies that we oftentimes look at are looking at ways to decrease the size of meals and make them more frequent. So you may hear this concept of kind of smaller, more frequent meals. For some, that looks like maybe eating more like six miniature meals spaced throughout the day. And depending on what your baseline appetite is right now, that's a place where working one-on-one with a dietitian can be really helpful to kind of figure out what those meals might look like for you right now. But oftentimes to start with, it looks like maybe increasing the frequency, focusing on more like every 1 to 2 hours or 2 to 3 hours, depending on what your current intake looks like. For some people, that also another helpful tool is actually offering smaller amounts. So you may have a very well-meaning family member or caregiver who is trying to fill up the entire plate in hopes of getting you to eat more. But sometimes what we find is when appetite is low, sometimes just the physical sight of a full plate can actually lead to eating less. So sometimes serving meals on a smaller plate, for example, a dinner plate, instead of a dinner plate, like a dessert plate or a side salad plate, can actually help sometimes make meals feel a little bit less daunting. Another strategy we look at is finding foods and fluids that have more calories. So if you're feeling full more quickly, finding foods that are going to get you more calories with less volume is also helpful. This can look like things that are higher in heart healthy fats. For example, something like a peanut butter or avocado, which are going to pack a lot of calories without necessarily adding more volume. Eating in pleasant surroundings. If you find you're less interested in eating, sometimes engaging in a meal where you have the opportunity to talk or visit with friends or family, or have a view or a sight that is more appealing, can also sometimes lend itself to eating a little bit more at a meal by allowing you to maximize on the non-food related aspects of a meal, some of the socializing or the views and things around you, which might help stimulate your interest in eating at a meal. Another strategy to think about is eating as part of your treatment. You may have heard doctors or nurses describe viewing eating as medicine. And part of the thought process there is, you know, when you're looking at your scheduling through medications throughout the day, it doesn't tend to be something that varies depending on how you're feeling. It's usually something that's a little bit more scheduled into your day. And when appetite is incredibly low, sometimes actually scheduling in times to eat, much like you would a medication, can actually be a helpful strategy to help you get some additional calories and protein in. When we think about those other ways to kind of boost calories, nutrients, protein in a meal, this is just one kind of example to start with. So if we think about oatmeal as your meal, what are possibly some ways that in that food that you're maybe already eating, we could add some calories without necessarily adding a lot of volume. So one option could be if you're making your oatmeal with water, perhaps making it with milk instead, because without adding more bites, we're going to enhance both the calories and the protein that you're getting from that same bowl of oatmeal. Oils can also be a great way to add some additional calories. Olive oil might not be the best fit for the oatmeal because it does have a little bit more of a savory flavor to it. But there are more neutral oils like canola oil or avocado oil that could be added in the process of making something like an oatmeal or a soup, or even a vegetable, just to enhance the number of calories you're getting per bite. Even adding something like a small sprinkle of granola or fruit could help add calories and nutrients to a food you might already be consuming. Again, peanut butter, which I mentioned before, that's a great way to add both calories and protein. And for something like oatmeal, can actually mix in so it's kind of doesn't add additional bites. It might kind of melt in through the process of making it. So if that's something you typically enjoy or can tolerate, that's another option. And then the last kind of potential add-in you could consider would be something like a protein powder. You can certainly add protein through food sources, but if you're finding that those things are unappealing, sometimes even having on hand an unflavored or even a flavored protein powder can be a great way to add in protein without adding quantity to what you're eating. Some additional strategies around appetite, using the clock. So you may find when you don't feel as much like eating, you're not noticing that natural drive for hunger or fullness that you may have felt in the past. So using a clock or a timer or a stopwatch in your kitchen can be a helpful tool to help remind you when it is time to eat. That might look different depending on what your situation is, but sometimes starting with setting a timer every 2 hours or 3 hours just to help get your body back in that pattern of eating more regularly. Drinking your nutrition can also be a helpful tool. Part of the reason for that is that liquids are digested more quickly than solids. So sometimes you may find a soup or a smoothie to be a little bit easier to tolerate than sitting down to a large plate of food. Physical activity is also helpful. Part of what drives our appetite is our level of activity and our body's need for calories and protein. So even adding in small amounts of walking or stretching might be beneficial in helping stimulate your appetite. These are some additional strategies for adding calories to your meals without necessarily adding quantity. So again, you'll notice a lot of these are things that fall in that category of heart-healthy fats. So things like adding chopped up nuts to your oatmeal or to a trail mix, avocado, which could be added, say, to a sandwich or made into a guacamole or added to scrambled eggs or blended into a smoothie. Similarly, nut or seed butters could be blended into a smoothie, added to a piece of fruit, added to crackers. Olive oil can be added to the pan before cooking veggies or eggs or drizzled on top at the end. And then avocado and canola oil are what we refer to as more neutral oils in that they don't carry as much flavor as the olive oil. So they can even be blended into something that might be sweet, more like a smoothie. Pesto is another great way to add calories without necessarily adding to quantity. And that could be added to things ranging from pasta to veggies or even spread on a sandwich. The next kind of symptom or challenge that I'm going to talk a little bit about is what you normally hear described as taste change. And what's actually, I think, interesting to point out about taste change is part of how when we think of taste, what we're actually talking about is flavor. Flavor is part of how our brain translates our experience with things that we're putting in our mouth or consuming. And it is actually made up of four different components. The physical taste of food when it's coming into our mouth getting exposed to our taste buds, the temperature of that food, the texture of that food, and also the smell of that food. Some of the most common changes to taste or flavor that we hear patients describe during treatment are things ranging from food that maybe is coming across as too bland, or things that are taking on a bitter or a bad taste, or perhaps a metallic taste or an enhanced taste. So maybe something is tasting too sweet or too salty. Some of these changes can happen because chemotherapies, because they are systemic medications, can actually change things even down to the level of our saliva. So sometimes those taste changes are the result of medications that you may be receiving, or changes in how much saliva is being produced in the mouth. Or if you're having something like radiation, there could even be a degree of the taste buds themselves actually being impacted by treatment. So you'll see here just listed some additional strategies around kind of each of these challenges. For example, if something is tasting too bland, ideas could range from adding things like fruit marinades, additional spices, trying to flavor things in a way that are more tart or sour, adding fresh herbs or hot sauces. If things are tasting bitter or bad, sometimes trialing flavors that are a little bit more potent in the sweet or salty variety can help offset some of those taste changes. Or sometimes even experimenting with things that are traditionally more bland or mild because they may not carry that same bitterness to them. Oral care is important. So dental hygiene, rinsing your mouth, if you're prescribed any baking soda or salt rinses, keeping up with those things can also help offset any negative tastes you might be experiencing. Some people find mints or gums or even lemon drops to help stimulate saliva in the mouth and help with those changes in taste. And again, sometimes experimenting with the temperature that foods are served at can also help with your experience around how those foods taste. For example, sometimes things that are at room temperature or cold may not have as potent a bad flavor to them as something that's served piping hot. So that's another place to experiment. And if you notice patterns around things that are working for you, using that to your advantage in choosing other meals or snacks as well. If things are tasting metallic, you'll notice some of the same patterns, but also even experimenting with plastic or bamboo utensils can sometimes be helpful. Avoid things that are wrapped in foil or canned. Sometimes that can also exacerbate that taste if that's something you're experiencing. If things are too sweet, you may find adding flavors that are more tart or sour to be helpful. Adding more like pungent or astringent flavors might offset that sweetness. Sprinkling on salty or savory toppings when appropriate, or sometimes diluting out beverages. So for example, if you were drinking fruit juice and it's too sweet, diluting that with water or herbal tea may also be helpful. Along the same lines of that taste change. Sometimes that also means you may have be experiencing changes in smell or have an increased sensitivity to smell. If that is the case for you, you may find it to be helpful to be out of the kitchen when meals are being prepared, if possible. If you are the one preparing the meals, if you have the opportunity to open windows, turn on the vent fan, that might be helpful to you. If it's something that needs to be like a liquid, using a straw or a lid can be helpful to minimize added smells if those are uncomfortable to you. Eat outdoors when possible, maybe not this time of year yet, but we're heading into that season where dining outdoors can be another way to eliminate some of the maybe excessive smells that you might be encountering in the kitchen or dining area. Sometimes minimizing the microwave to reheat leftovers is also helpful because the microwave tends to amplify any smells you're experiencing. If you've ever been in an office building where someone has burnt popcorn, you know smells can have a tendency to linger a little bit longer in the microwave. So reheating in the oven or on the stovetop or under the broiler might also work to your advantage. And then foods that are meant to be eaten colder at room temperature tend to have less smell associated with them. So that may also be another place to start if you're having specific aversions to smell. Dry mouth can be another side effect that can be associated with some forms of treatment. If you're finding that it is difficult to eat certain foods, you may find, again, breaking it up into smaller meals and snacks throughout the day may make it easier to get in more total calories. Alternating between bites of food and sips of liquid can also be a strategy to help with breaking down food in your mouth. Part of the role of saliva is to actually help both with enzymes and liquid that are going to break down food as you start to chew and swallow. So if you're not naturally producing as much saliva, having some liquid in between bites may help with your process of chewing and swallowing. That same concept applies to adding things like sauces, broths, or gravies, or choosing meals that are naturally a little bit more tender and have more liquid. So for example, something like a shepherd's pie that may naturally have a little bit more of a liquid component to it and a softer texture may be helpful if you're experiencing dry mouth. In terms of hydration, continuing to sip fluids throughout the day may help with any discomfort you're having related to dry mouth. Oral hygiene is also important here. If you're prescribed any rinses, like a baking soda or salt rinse or other rinses, that may be beneficial. Hard candies or even sucking on frozen fruit, like frozen melons or grape, may help offset any discomfort you're having from a dry mouth. And then limiting any mouthwashes that contain alcohol, as these can be not only uncomfortable, but can actually dry the mouth out more. The next symptom I want to talk about is what's referred to as mucositis or esophagitis, or essentially inflammation or swelling of the mouth, oral cavity, or esophagus. This could be something that is happening because of chemotherapy that causes mouth sores. It could be related to radiation. In this situation, you may find that you are more sensitive to things that are spicy. So especially if you're having discomfort as you eat and swallow, you may find avoiding things like chili powders, curry, cloves, black pepper. Those foods might be uncomfortable for you. And if they are, use less or minimize those things in cooking during that window of time where you're having those symptoms. Foods that are softer in texture, while not required, may be more comfortable because if you ever think about if you've had a sore throat and you ate a chip or something with a very sharp edge, those foods, you may just feel that more as you're chewing and swallowing. So in general, softer textures might be a little more comfortable. You may also find foods that are served, again, cooler at room temperature to be more soothing to the throat. So that's something to potentially consider. For example, sipping on a smoothie might be more comfortable to your throat than eating a hot soup. The same principle applies for avoiding alcohol or alcohol-containing mouthwashes, as those can not only be drying, but sometimes irritating to the mouth and throat. Continuing to follow good oral care, doing any rinses that are recommended. You may also be prescribed things that are actually mouthwashes for pain control. So things that might be referred to as like a swish and swallow medication or a magic mouthwash. And these things are meant to actually provide some relief to the pain that you may be feeling with swallowing. You may find it helpful to choose, if those cool temperatures are helpful, maybe choosing a smoothie that contains lower acid fruits. Things like sometimes strawberries or citrus tend to be a little bit more acidic, so those foods may cause you burning or discomfort if that is a symptom you're experiencing. The same thing could apply to things that are kind of heavy in tomatoes or pickled. Again, if those foods are uncomfortable, limiting those when you're experiencing that symptom of inflammation. Along the lines of foods that are a little bit easier to chew and swallow, that could look like smoothies, it might look like eggs, quiche, frittatas, soups, potentially things like yogurt or cottage cheese, maybe over a chicken breast, something like a chicken, tuna, or egg salad. Fish is a nice flaky, soft protein source. Hummus is another great option if that is something you enjoy. Fatigue is another symptom that tends to come up during treatment-related conversations. This is a little bit broader symptom because when we think about what is fatigue, it's actually a lot broader definition than we might think. It ranges from, you know, feeling weak to tired, exhausted, worn out, maybe feeling a little slower than usual, perhaps a kind of a mental fuzziness or cloudiness or difficulty concentrating. And this can have a range of causes. It can range from things from not eating enough food or taking in enough fluids. Weight loss can contribute to this. Pain can contribute to this. Medications, treatment can contribute to fatigue. Sleep disturbances can contribute to fatigue. But when asked, 70 to 100% of patients on treatment, according to the American Cancer Society, reported experiencing fatigue. So when we think about fatigue and nutrition, what can be challenging is if you're feeling fatigued and part of that is happening because you're not eating enough, if you're not having enough energy to prepare meals or kind of encourage yourself to eat, that can definitely exacerbate any existing fatigue, whether it had to do with eating to begin with or not. So some strategies we think about are maybe looking at ways to make meals easier to prepare. So for example, maybe using a crock pot, or if there's a period of time when your fatigue is lowest, using that opportunity to maybe cook some meals in advance to throw in the freezer. Focus again on foods that are calorie dense. So using those heart healthy fats we talked about earlier, nuts, avocado, olive oil. Getting more calories in less volume can be helpful, even if something like chewing is causing you fatigue right now. Keep snacks on hand, fresh fruit, nuts, peanut butter, crackers. Have those things in your pantry, your fridge, maybe even by where you normally sit throughout the day, if even the process of getting up to go to the kitchen is more energy than you have right now. Focusing on soft and easy to chew foods. Again, if chewing is even causing fatigue beyond what you can handle right now, things like soups, smoothies, egg salad, chicken salad, tuna salad, fish might be easier to tolerate in that window of time. And again, eating smaller, more frequent meals, especially if not eating often enough is contributing to the fatigue, might be helpful. Hydration is also important. If you are not feeling like you have enough energy, sometimes it's because you're not getting enough fluid. Strategies for getting more fluid: carrying a reusable water bottle with you. If you have that at hand, it's easier to more reliably drink more fluid. If you're not a water drinker, finding ways to make it more palatable. That could look like infusing your water with a variety of fresh herbs and spices. Maybe you throw some cucumber and watermelon in there, or basil and strawberries, or orange and mint. Adding those kind of splash of fruit or herbs infused in the water might make it more palatable and easier to drink. You could also add a splash of juice or something else in the water for flavor. If you're worried about hydration, also remembering that all liquids really do count towards your hydration goal. So that could be soups. It could be something like a seltzer. Just knowing that we're not talking just water when we're talking hydration. You may also find things like herbal teas, hot or iced, helpful in increasing your fluid intake. And if you're uncertain how much fluid you're getting, sometimes just tracking a typical day gives you a good sense of if you are in fact getting enough or if you're falling short. Other things to consider if you're feeling fatigued is to ask for help if needed. Sometimes if people are looking for ways to help, asking for assistance with maybe preparing meals, or if you enjoy preparing meals, maybe it's having a friend or a family member help with another chore that allows you to have enough energy left over to still be able to do what you want to in the kitchen. And as I mentioned before, light activity can have the benefit of stimulating appetite, but actually even adding in a couple of minutes of activity every hour, could look like as few as 100 steps, can actually contribute towards offsetting symptoms of fatigue, especially related to cancer treatment. So this was just, again, our recap on the second set of symptoms related to treatment. Please don't hesitate if you have individual questions in reviewing through these slides. You can certainly schedule a consult with any of the dietitians here at Dana-Farber. You can reach out either to your individual clinic to request an appointment, or you can also call the voicemail box for nutrition scheduling at 617-632-3006. And usually you'll hear back from our scheduling coordinator within 24 to 48 hours, again, or you can reach out through your individual clinic. Thank you for joining us today.